I want to show you now a few examples, a few experiences, a few empirical studies, a few sort of explorations we've done within this framework of walkability evaluation, right? In particular, we have developed a software which is freely available on the web, so you can download it, play with it, use it if you need to make your own. Of course, again, here is much better. That's just. And I was telling, we were discussing during the coffee break. I told you about the attributes and the weights and the modeling and the parameters of the model. Okay, the software is designed so that you can change the specification and parameters of the model. So, for instance, she was telling to me, your name, excuse me?
Amalia
was talking to me about her idea to sort of try to evaluate the natural parks. Is it not? Okay. And, well, if you needed to adapt this kind of approach, you could use the same software and then put different attributes, which are relevant, for instance, for the natural trails and not for the urban streets. Okay. So you can sort of adapt and put whatever you think is relevant from your methodological point of view or given the purpose of the evaluation. Okay. So here is one application to the town of Alghero, which is here. This is Italy. You kind of see the boot. And this is the Sardinia island, okay? And it is on the northern western part of Sardinia. Okay, maybe you get it here better, all right? And this is Alghero, okay? So this is kind of it's a 40,000 people, 40,000 inhabitant, kind of quite a touristic destination, but also with a stable resident population. Just to give you kind of a feeling of what we are talking about. It is interesting because besides the urban core, it has a quite a wide surrounding naturalistic environment with some, also not, a natural park is attached further north to the town. So from the point of view of touristic use, it is attractive not as not only and not as much as a town, but as a sort of a nexus of urban kind of a touristic attraction and territorial environmental place. It is of course very, very much visited during the summer because it has beaches and so on and so on. Okay, so what we did is let's map the walkability the way we have defined it. And this map summarizes all the information that are all the three set of information that are necessary to to determine the walkability, the capability-wise walkability score. Okay, again, perhaps here you see it more colorful, but let's see what's on the map. First of all, you see destinations, all these dots, triangles or circular dots or gray areas, which are different families, different categories of attractions. Okay, so services, retail and commercial activities, green and recreational facilities. This includes also the beach. So also the seaside as a green and recreational area is as an environmental attraction, okay? So these are our opportunities categorized capability-wise. Let's call it this way. Then we have this street network, which is color-coded, as you see. So that green means that it is green, basically, the number attached to every street segment gives you the, remember, the cost in terms of walkability. So the lower the cost, the more walkable that segment is. This is what we called before the walkability in itself. Okay, so basically, this one is green. This one is green. Green is towards zero. It means that considering all the 20 attributes, the street, the cars, it has a low cost of pedestrians, meaning inversely high walkability. Then you have those which are red. For instance, take as an example this one here or this one here. It means that it has low walkability, high cost from the pedestrian point of view. Again, note the distinction. This walkability that I measure here is just a cost, cost per meter, okay? Meaning the walkability in itself. If I wanted to measure how much every street segment is walkable in itself, given its attributes, physical, design, uses, I would have this map, and it would be enough. I would stop there, okay? So it tells you that if you walk here, you would have a pleasant walk. Here, you would be disturbed, you would have a poor pavement, and so on and so on. Okay, so this information, again, is bundled together to give our walkability score, which takes into account both how walkable in itself the streets are and how many destinations you have nearby. So again, as an example, if to learn what is the walkability score of this point here, you would take into account how many opportunities I have within different distances. The farther away, the less relevant it is. It is weighted less. Again, we are taking account the distance. We are also taking account then what? The quality, and also we are taking account their number and diversity. You get it? So this is the point. And this, so this map is basically, it shows you all the information that we bundle together to calculate walkability scores, the capability-wise, or this is the kind of walkability scores, score mapped. This is related to leisure, meaning recreational areas, environmental attractions, public spaces, and so on and so on, okay? And you have this geography, you see? So here, you really get that information. If it is, the darker it is, maybe you can get, again, compare the colors, the darker it is, it means the higher the walkability, the greater intensity. Meaning that if you are here, or here, or perhaps here, you would be in a place which have a lot of nearby, again, environmental recreation attractions, which are pleasant to reach by foot. Get it? So, as Antonio have intuited before, we don't get just one walkability score map. This one is related to this capability, the capability to recreate, to go to green areas, and so on and so on. And it bundles different kind of opportunities. Another bundle of opportunities in space are commercial and retail areas. You see, this is a different map. Again, related to commercial activities, shops, restaurants, blah, blah, blah. Okay, supermarkets, et cetera, et cetera. Okay? And this one is related to services, public services, banks, all kind of, you know, other kind of services. I can then tell you what we, health services, pharmacies, and so on and so on. Okay? These are bundled together to get this map. So three walkability maps. You get the point. You can be in a place where your capability-wise walkability might be high from the point of view of shopping and restaurants, but low in terms of services and low in terms of leisure. Or you can be in a place, luckily, where all three are high. Okay, so you can have further aggregation. Let's see how this can be used as a planning support, as a system for supporting decision making, okay? Public policies, okay? Some ideas. This one is an interesting combination between the maps we've just seen, the walkability score, the maps of walkability scores, and the information on the population, the residential population. The map you've seen before tells you the walkability of points in place, in space, okay? But how relevant is this from the policy point of view? This, the walkability of this point is low. Well, perhaps there is nobody there. Perhaps it is just the woods, or I don't know what. And it is irrelevant to have this place highly walkable, okay? What is relevant, in a way, is how this related to the spatial differences between people, okay? So if I say, about this map, I superimpose to this map the densities of population where people live, I can then attach to every person who lives in a specific point in place, a score, a walkability score. You get it? So now I can not just have the spatial variability of walkability, but I can also have the variability between people. This can, in a way, be, say, called the inequalities of walkability between residents, between people who live in the town. And this is how you get it. It is very, barely visible, but you can see here, it's a histogram, okay? And what does it say? For instance, these are commercial attractions, okay, commercial. You have walkability score and number of inhabitants. And here all the different bars of the histogram, which I don't know how. I could, okay? But you can, if I show you, you can imagine, okay, what a histogram. You can, because here is the same, but it's farther away. So, if I have walkability score and have a histogram, okay? What does it tell me? It tells me this is number of people. Not number of pixels, okay? But number of people. So, I see that there is a certain amount of people, I don't know, 2,000 people, who live in a neighborhood, in a place, with a very low walkability. This is a place where they don't have opportunities, where to have a coffee or to buy cigarettes or to get for food, they have to either take a bus or a car or go far away, okay? There are people who are rich from the point of view of the capabilities endowment related to the specific area of interest, commercial and retail. Okay? The same with services, the same with green and recreational areas. So, okay, I can here, in a way, evaluate, measure the social, the spatial inequalities in terms of and capabilities they are able to possess in their capability sets, which can be used through walking. These are people. These are, again, synthetic comparison between distributions. Again, we have box plots, so it tells you that how, again, it's the same data, same information, just more synthetically represented. This is how people are distributed. This is the median value. This is the first quartile, third quartile, and then you get the distribution. So what I see here, for instance, comparing people, I see that the variability within the capability of commercial and retail activities is higher than within services, and it is somewhere greater than within the area of leisure. Okay. What else I can do? I can compare neighborhoods. Not people, but neighborhoods. These are six historical neighborhoods of the city of the town of Alghero. Carmine, Caragol, Fertilia, Calabona, Pietra, blah, blah, blah. Okay, never mind. And it tells you within, taking into account retail and commercial opportunities in space, you see that people who are living in this neighborhood have a very low walkability capability and also the variability within the neighborhood is very low. Meaning, on the level of neighborhood, it is on average very low and they all get it low, okay? You get, so these are the neighborhoods, then this one, and this is the city center, of course. This is Sant'Agostino, it is quite, this is an interesting neighborhood because it is not as central as city center, but you see it's a neighborhood with quite a wide kind of internal variability, but with a central tendency which is much higher than these other neighborhoods. Pietraia and Lido is a big neighborhood, okay? Interesting neighborhood, socially quite diverse, with kind of higher than those which are very low on retail and commercial, but you see somewhere in the average in comparison with the other two neighborhoods. Okay? And this is just retail and commercial. You can say, what about the services? And you get another kind of. What about green areas and recreational facilities? You see, the picture is different. Now, this neighborhood is better on the average, and city center is low. Although you have a lot of outliers, you have a lot of people, maybe some sub areas, some blocks where effectively the capabilities to recreate in green areas is quite high. Okay, so you always have to look at both the central tendency, this is the median value, and the extremes. Okay. Another thing you can do, then, following this kind of stream of thought, is to classify, to categorize neighborhoods of city areas in terms of score, walkability score thresholds. We've done this in a paper that is being, we are preparing a paper on relationship between walkability and periphericity of cities, okay? What if walkability is a measure, is a proxy measure of the peripherality of an urban area? What is a periphery? Is periphery just a sort of geometrical concept of being far away from the center? Or is periphery rather also, besides all the social, demographic, economical aspects, also a place where, again, to get a coffee or a pack of cigarettes or to shop or to get your children to school, you have to take a car? Isn't that a periphery? And if you are in a neighborhood, although perhaps far away from the body center of the urban area, where you then have all these opportunities within a walking distance in a pleasant environment, although if it is far away, it is not a periphery conceptually, it is urban core. Okay? So based on this idea, let's say, what about we define some threshold of scores? If the walkability score on average is less than 10, then it is full periphery. We call that full periphery. From 10 to 20, these are just numbers that the model provides, the one we've seen before. Then it is semi-periphery. If it is from 10 to 30, then it is semi-core, and then about 30, it is a core, urban core, okay? And if we do that, taking into account all three categories of capability scores, of walkability scores, excuse me, then I can classify my six neighborhoods that we've seen before, that I've mentioned before, in terms of peripheries. What this threshold mean in practice, you can, these are a few examples. This is a point in space that has a walkability score of 5, meaning here it has just these destinations which are attractive and they're quite far away and probably, you see, they are not as attractive to walk. This is walkability score 26, this point, the red dot, and all these attractions that are within its proximity, and so on. So these thresholds we have, yeah, thresholds. So there is a bit of sort of arbitrariness in picking out the thresholds, but it is an interesting tool to then say, well, this neighborhood is periphery from the point of view of retail and commercial opportunities and services. It is not as a periphery in terms of green and recreational, it's just a semi-periphery. You have a neighborhood which is city center, which is a core, and a core from the point of view of services, but it is not a core. Yes, it is a core also in terms of green areas. This, the other neighborhood I've told you before is core from the two points of view, but not from the third point of view. And so on and so on. So you see, this kind of, this tool then allows you to extract, to generate articulated geographies of capabilities in space related to walkability. It is not just this is walkable, this is not walkable. It is walkable, depends on which opportunities you take into account, and I now want to add, it depends on which class of users, class of urban population you take into account. Because, this is just an example, walkability for parents. If you're a parent, you would like to have a basket of, a bundle of opportunities that are relevant for you as a parent. When I say you're a parent, of course you're not only a parent. You're also many other things. You're a university professor, you are a person who loves opera, and so on, so on, so on. And being these other things, of course, makes me interested in other opportunities. But as a parent, I'm interested in a set of opportunities. The schools, the supermarkets, food shops, institutional services, banks, green areas, urban parks. This is the bundle of, conventional bundle of what parents would like to live in, with what people as parents would like to have. And you get a geography of walkability for parents. Again, the map is the same, the information is the same. Just what changes here is just the bundle of attractions. What also might change is the bundle of, it's the combination of weights I give to different attributes. If I am, I'm a person who needs to cutter around in a car, a small child, it is a different attributes that counts for me for walkability because I have to push my cart. Okay? And so I can change that also in the model and get another geography. This is how parents would see the city. You get it? Huh? This is for tourists. Tourists have different sets of preferences. They are interested in accommodation services, entertainment, bars and commercial services, blah, blah, blah. Okay? And you can put here whatever you think might be relevant for your, as a bundle of opportunities that tourists would like to see. Okay, and you get another map. So if you're tourists, okay, this is the map you as a tourist would say, okay, so it's better that I get a hotel room here. Okay, although TripAdvisor tells me the best hotel is here and it is quite inexpensive, you don't see this kind of map. Okay, this is what I was missing when I was picking my hotel in Beijing. And what I did, I asked a person who was there and said, okay, this area is interesting, there is a shopping, it is quite secure, nobody will rob you, and so, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, okay, now I believe you and I go there. Okay, basically it's this. Okay, well, there are some other uses possible. So I told you, different categories, possibility to see distribution, inequalities in space, variability in space, variability among people, profiling, You can also measure the effect of investment in space or of new services, new functions that are added, and the difference between just adding a service and adding a service and jointly improving the walkability of streets. Okay, so for instance, this is a neighborhood. This is an example, just sort of a theoretical example we measured in the software. This is the neighborhood. Let's say we put here a new cultural center, a museum, something, okay, here. And of course, without doing anything to the city. And of course, just by adding a new opportunity, it changes the landscape of walkability to the people, although I haven't improved streets. You get it? Because it is taken into account. And then the third scenario is I do that, and then I also make some improvements, making the streets more walkable, more pleasant, more attractive, and so on, and so on. And you can measure the differential effect of that policy. So again, you get it. It can evaluate, it can tell you, sort of simulate what happens based on what your urban project is. And based on this idea, we've done another case study. This is the first, actually, we've done. Okay, and it was a thesis by a student who has worked and has developed this plan of transforming the second ring road in Lisbon from basically an urban highway, this kind of things, okay? You get it. So it's basically, this is the second ring road, okay? And the plan is to, the idea, the concept, is to transform this in more urban boulevard, something that is, it allows pedestrian uses, slows down the car traffic, and so on, okay? So, and she has developed a master plan of what to do with all different services that might be localized. But above all, she has worked on what? On transforming the infrastructure, transforming the physical highway into a more urban boulevard avenue. You get it? And so what we wanted to do is to evaluate what happens, what changes with the walkability, with the capabilities of people in terms of walkability, once that project would be implemented. So what you can do with the software also is, of course, you get the attractions. This is something that we harvest from different sources, Google and so on, that gets you all the attractions. And then you put into the software the current situation, the current network, and the plan. So you describe basically all the different actions, interventions, projects all along the highway and nearby in the neighborhoods that might improve walkability. So just as an example, this is our second ring. You see there is this big crossing with, you know, you can imagine what this is from the pedestrian point of view. And, well, she said, okay, let's do a little roundabout with crossings. Let's downgrade, let's lower the speed, let's improve the connections, intersect the permeability from north to south, and so on. So this thing has been implemented. She has put all the attributes as it is now and as it is intended to be within the project. Okay? And then you press the button and the system, the software tells you what happens in terms of improvement of walkability. It tells you, okay, this is the current situation in terms of leisure and commerce. This is the delta, the variation of capabilities in terms of walkability once the project is implemented. So you get it. This is not so much adding new things. Yes, also. But this is leaving the services and attractions along the road as it is, just few improvements, and just improvements related to the fact that now people, before it was a barrier, before it was a limit, before people from the north weren't able to cross easily, and especially by foot, to the south. So if you had a supermarket here, you wouldn't be able to. And now you could. So just as changing the urban environment, you have improved the capability of people without changing, adding too much new things, attractions, and so on and so on. And you get this kind of another things. And this information can then be shown in different ways. This is a funny way to show it. This is, okay, in the area you've seen, about 200 people, 200,000 people live in the area of Lisbon. Okay, so this map, this graph, this scatter plot, has 200,000 dots, okay? And each dot is related to one person. So it tells you his or her current situation and the project score. So for instance, this one currently has 15, and if the project is done, goes to 23, okay? So it sort of maps all the people and what happens to them if you do the design, if you implement the project, okay? And you see that the great majority gets their situation improved. Some are below the dividing line. All points that are below, of course, in the future will have less capability-wise, than with the project. It also tells you not only how many people will improve their condition, but who gets what. Okay, this one tells me that those who are really badly in bad condition now will not improve as much. Okay, those here who are now around 15-25 have also some big improvements. Okay, so you can also evaluate with this, not only the overall effect, the aggregate effect of projects, but also the distributional, the equitability of your projects. You can say, let's design something, okay, let's say, you can also say, let's try to make a design that, you know, if you're a 20, you're okay. You're okay. I don't have to care too much about you. Especially if there is a lot of people who are below 10. Let's see if I can change design so that these people have greater increase. Or let's make a design that is cost efficient to maximize the average improvement. These are also, these all are, of course, political, ethical goals. It is not something that I impose through the software. You can use it as a tool to make different scenario of effects of your policies, of your designs, okay? So this is just recreational. This is what happens in the area of services. Okay, it's another map. Yeah.
Do you have a question? How we can know who are the people that the?
Well, yes, I can. How I got that person because what I did again. It is the same combination I explained before. You get the map of variation, and then use the census data to see, okay. So yes, I can tell you this person exactly where, and this is interesting because I can say, okay, these people here are in that neighborhood. These people here are in that area. I am excluding them. I'm giving them maybe too much. And these people here, perhaps, you see, maybe this is just a few blocks of houses that I forgot something about. Let's do this. We don't want people to lose, for instance. Okay. So yes, every dot is, I can, for every person, know his or her current score, future score, and of course, the point in space. Of course. The place in space. Okay. This is just a synthetic way to present the same data. what happens with the walkability score with regard to commerce, current situation, and project. So you see the median value increases, and also globally it is shifted upward. Services and services and recreation. Okay? Of course, I can do, for instance, for tourists. What happens for attractivity for tourists? If I, or for other population, as long as I'm able to define what? The bundle of attractions and the weight of each attraction relevant for that specific population, the weight of single attributes that are relevant for walkability of that specific population. Okay? Okay, fine. I will also tell you a little bit about another idea we are exploring and we are working on, which is, okay, now think about it. If I can evaluate the situation as it is now, and then I can input in the software a project, and the software can tell me what's the difference, what are the gains, what are the effects of the project, why not think about something that instead of me doing the project, I tell the machine that I have specific objectives, make more equal situation, final situation, or improve walkability in specific neighborhoods, or improve conditions for children, and ask the computer to do the project for me. Because it can calculate, and it can, at least in the Lennon principle, tell me what is the most effective set of interventions that can maximize some specific objective function. Okay? So it is an inverse problem. Rather than telling you, I have a project, tell me what happens, I tell you what I want to happen, and you tell me the project. Okay? Now, of course, the machines don't project yet. Okay, we have to wait 5 to 10 years, and then we are unemployed, all of us. Okay, for now they don't exactly design, but what it gives me with this system, it tells me which edges to improve. So it gives me a project that says, okay, if you want to improve the walkability of that neighborhood, you have to improve this part of the street network. It also can hint me what to improve. Here you have to add some, here you have to widen, here you have to take care of that and this. Okay. And it can suggest me a set of interventions, of actions, which might be counterintuitive. The machines design differently than people. People usually, when you design, you say, you have a project, okay, let's improve all this boulevard and do some renovation in all this. No? In more, the solutions this one gives, I'd rather do a little bit here, a little bit here, a little bit here, because they are jointly cost effective. So it can, I don't call these designs, but I call them, you know, hinting systems, like you would, you know, like chess grandmasters play the chess. They play the chess and have a computer here, and they ask the computer what to do, and then they evaluate, and then, you know, well, no, he don't, and then sort of evaluate the, so it is a hinting system. It helps you sort of devise designs. Then you still have to have architects, planners, urban designers to build the project. But it can help you do this. Of course, to do that, computationally, it is very expensive. It is a hard problem because, as you can get, the number of solutions and the alternatives it has to evaluate explodes very early as the number of, as the size of the street network grows. So, we have developed, in particular, I have a colleague who has developed specific heuristics, who is working on computational heuristics that are able to arrive at, you can't grant they are optimal, they are the best solutions, but they are reasonably good too. And what it does, this is interesting, so I won't go too much into technical sort of optimization, the problems of optimization here. I will show you just an example. So here, let's say, I want to improve the walkability of this area with regard to their capability to recreate in green in urban parks, okay? And you press the button and the system offers you this, or this, which you say, okay, what's the fuss? So this is the set of all the solutions with regard to magnitude of improvement and with regard to the effort, to the cost. So this is so-called Pareto, the Pareto frontier, meaning that you can invest a little, and if you press here, it tells you where you have to improve, and this is sort of the best set of solutions that will improve you so much, given that you want to invest, I don't know, 1 million of euros, okay? If you want to invest more money, then you can click here, and of course, the improvement is greater. So you see, it is kind of a, now we have to compare both the effort into doing a project, and there is not an optimal project in itself. These are all cost effective. If you spend this effort, okay, this is the best kind of family of projects that you have to consider. Okay? But given less money, less time, less effort, you can do these projects. Okay? So if you click on one of those, you click on this point, it then draws you all the edges, all the streets you need to make your improvement. So again, your example would be what came to my mind, that you say, I want specific goals in terms of, you click and it tells me which are the points that are more cost effective or effort effective for improving, for getting to that objective. Okay. Now, I want to show you some empirical, again, some other empirical studies we've done on this topic. But if there are questions, if there is something that you want me to clarify, just stop me now and let's discuss it. We're all good? Okay, fine. So this one is one recent empirical study that you've done, the purpose was to determine which factors are more relevant, we were talking about this, for the perception of pedestrian walkability. So basically, what you have to take into account, what are the relevant factors for the perception of walkability? The perception of walkability, the subjective evaluation of walkability. Okay? Of course, we know from literature, from other experiences, from environmental psychology and so on, that individual characteristics count. Age, gender, income, that mobility opportunities count, the type and the purpose of the trip count, but also that the features of walking environment count. So, letting aside the first three set of attributes, we wanted to explore which features of the walking environment are more or less relevant for the subjective perception of walkability. Okay? This is not the only, this is not the first study, so I'm just showing you something we've done recently. And the purpose was partially also to calibrate and validate the model, evaluation model that I explained to you before. Remember, there were attributes and then there were weights. How much every, okay. Instead of me just giving weights based on my experience or my expert knowledge, I said, let's ask people, basically. Okay, now people lie all the time, of course. We know that, okay? But let's see if we can empirically devise a way to come to the parameters, to arrive at the parameters of the evaluation model, okay? And so, this is the empirical study. It is an empirical study on street segments. So every, you see, you remember the segments, the edges, okay? Every single edge is our statistical unit, is something that I evaluate. And it has been done for the whole city of Alghero, okay? So there are 408 street segments in the graph, and we divided the city in 10 sectors, okay? And for each segment, we have measured two things, okay? One is an analytic description of the segment through 18 observable street attributes. So for every segment, you score it, you measure it, you say, you remember the attributes you've seen before? Those attributes, okay? You remember? You don't, okay? I'm showing you too much time, too much things. These attributes. These attributes, okay? They are all together these and these. They're all together 18 in this study that we've done with okay? So, I think besides the results in itself, I think this is perhaps a study that is interesting from the methodological point of view. Maybe during the coffee break, some of you told me about what you're planning to do, and maybe this might be a way that you come right to your results, what you want to think. Because, again, I was saying, what do we measure for each of the 408 segments? You get it? So you have a table of 408 rows, and for each row, which is a split segment, you have a description with 18 attributes, 18 columns, okay? And then also you have a synthetic, subjective perception of its quality. Okay? So how do you do that? Basically, you take undergraduate students, okay, turn them into slaves, and get them to walk around the town and do the survey, do the auditing. Okay? So this is what we've done. With 20 students, okay, they were divided in couples, in pairs, and each was auditing one of the 10 sectors. So the town was divided in 10 sectors, you see? There is a map there which you wouldn't see if you were looking just there. You would miss, okay? And each was auditing one sector, meaning each was measuring or expressing judgment on one sector, the edges, and provide synthetic subjective evaluation in another sector. And that was done so that they don't condition themselves by, I first saw it, I analytically analyzed how wide is it, and then if I ask you what is your subjective perception, I might. So in one sector, they were doing measurements and judgments on each of the 18 attributes. In the other sector, they were just walking and saying, okay, this segment is great, this one is low, walkability, and so on, expressing subjective perception. So we've seen 18 these are the attributes. So again, those largely seen before, sidewalk, the width, the environmental attractions, density of shop, blah, blah, blah. We've seen this, okay? We've seen this. What is a synthetic evaluation? This is the card they have received so that we kind of incentivize them to have a uniform interpretation of the scale. Okay? Because it's a subjective, evaluative judgment. Okay? So they had to score each segment on a scale from 1 to 5, and it is clearly an ordinal qualitative scale. And so this is the card that was given to them. This is sort of I'm showing you the part of the design of the study, okay? So this is what they were asked to do, express. I want to read it because so you get exactly the meaning of the numbers that we are then mixing together. Express a synthetic evaluation of your perception of the quality and walkability of the street from your point of view as pedestrian. The evaluation must be expressed on a qualitative scale from 1, insufficient, to 5, excellent. Taking into account the physical features of the pedestrian walkway, the overall qualitative characteristic of the urban space, and in general, how you perceive the street to be safe, comfortable, pleasant, attractive, and usable. In order to express your evaluation, you must not take into account the distance from the city center, nor the temporary sources of disturbance, such as public works, construction in progress, and so on. Okay? Following are the meanings of each evaluation level. Excellent means maximum pedestrian comfort. The street is very pleasant to walk, with particularly attractive and valuable surrounding urban space or landscape, where it is interesting to walk, sit, and hang out. This is excellent. Okay. So if you say, this is what I'm seeing, 5. Okay. Insufficient. Okay. Now you can read it through, but doesn't you get the point. The point I'm trying to make is that you have to be very careful when you design empirical studies and you ask people to grade things on a qualitative scale. Okay. In order, I'm obviously stating the obvious and things that you know, but since you are working on this, you told me that, for instance, your data have this information of the subjective perception of positive, negative, okay? You have to be careful. Errors of judgment are unavoidable. People are different. People lie all the time. People, okay, all these are true. Knowing that we are in the world of this kind of uncertainty of the data, okay, you have to do all your best to make sure that you've done everything possible so that the understanding of the meaning of the scale is uniform, as uniform as possible. Yes?
Ivan, one question which is probably a bit complex, because it means that endogenous
factor. Yeah, yeah.
How do you deal with crowding?
We don't. We haven't. This is another dimension. It has to do with what I was suggesting before, the social practices of use of space. There are some other things that might be relevant that we haven't spoke about, and that might all be interesting add-ons to the basic model.
Because in that case, the subjective evaluation that would interfere with that.
Absolutely. It would interfere in many different ways. I might enjoy crowding, but not too much crowding. Okay, so the value function might be that the optimal is somewhere in the middle. I might enjoy crowding depending on who the crowd is. Okay, so I might, if I'm a racist, you get the point. Okay, subjectively, I'm sorry. If I am a racist, this is how I would subjectively value that. Okay, maybe it is great, but something is going on and I don't like it. And
this is one of the things that make the analytic evaluation very different from the subjective one, because the subjective also.
Well. You could. Another thing that's interesting is the daily cycle. Things that happens in the morning, in the afternoon, and in the evening on some streets are completely different things. And also your propensity to walk is very different based on the time of the day. The seasons are also relevant depending on the climates, on the conditions. So yes, these are all aspects. But you see, if we sort of share the common framework of the logic, basic logic, we can think about it. It might be operationally complicated to measure. It might be operationally complicated or expensive to get all the information. But based on what you're looking for, I'm absolutely, you can have also mimetic interpretation of what I like because other people like it. So it is completely imitative. Tourism is a lot a mimetic behavior. I go there because other people are telling me that it is because they desire to go there. So the desire is imitated. Okay, I'm 100% with you on that. Okay, and this is an interesting field that we should be able to explore. And
next paper.
Next paper, but also PhD thesis. So yes, let's talk about it. Let's talk about it. You know, also the story I told you yesterday about the taste of money is exactly that. Yes. So in a way, I get your critic. There is a kind of a excess of rationalization and positivistic attitude when you mix and when you think that subjective is just as banal as and so dependent. So yes, I agree. So we have to tackle problems with different tools. And this is not the only one, of course. It is just a tool. Okay. Good. So this is the scale. So what happens is that once you get the measures on 18 attributes, and once you have one synthetic, then you can do all the statistical analysis you want, all the regression models, all the test of correlation. This is an example of simple multivariate linear regression model in which we sort of estimated the significance and the importance of each attribute if we had to aggregate their values in a linear model.
On the synthetic model?
Yes, on the synthetic, yes. So basically, this is the standard presentation. So you have the estimate value of the slope, standard error, and the p-value, okay? So this is the model when you put all 18 attributes. I will tell you which these attributes are, so 18 attributes. Another model, and this model has an R squared of about 0.060, which is not bad, being that we are in the world of, we are dealing with people and not with strictly talking with physical phenomena, okay? Then there is another model, the model B, which is a bit simpler because it excludes those attributes that have shown to be statistically of low significance. This one includes about 10, I think, or 11 attributes. And this one, with an R squared of 0.056. So you see, we are losing a bit of explanatory power, but we are simplifying the model radically. So because the idea was, let's see what counts more for the people, what's most relevant. And we got to this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. So factors, variables. Of course, you can attend different kind of models. We are now playing with other kind of models, including outranking, a set of outranking classification models, okay, of which ELECTRI is just one special case, okay, which yield some little improvement, but not as much, okay. So I tend to sacrifice a bit of explanatory power if I can greatly simplify the model. But it's an interesting to explore the data also from and try to all the things that might work. So the results, the 9 variables, this is model B, jointly are most strongly associated with the overall synthetic perception of walkability. These were the results of our study. So again, it largely depends on who the auditors are. We were dealing with students who have their own perceptions, their own judgments, and so I'm sure that if I was asking...
The dependent variable is categorical.
The dependent variable is, yes, categorical. Yes. But it is an ordinal categorical, so under certain circumstances, you can treat it in a multivariate regression. Then you can use a logistic. You can use other models or analysis of variance, and we've tried them all, and we didn't yield too much of a difference. So all the slight differences in significance are really irrelevant in given the possibility of evaluation and measurement error at the origin. So you would get the same result. So these are sort of what are the variables that has come out that are shown to be most relevant for estimating the subjective perception. So basically, if you know this, you are reasonably well able to predict how the people would subjectively evaluate the street. This is the point of the evaluation. Okay? Useful with objects of architectural, urban, environmental attraction, density of shops, buses, economic activities, opportunity to sit, shelters and shade, the width of the car, railways, the tracks, bicycle tracks, the separation between vehicles and pedestrians, the street lighting. Okay? So if you put this in a linear model and then you get at a value, which you then round to get one of the five classes, you classify the roads. What is the point of this? If I measure a street and get those values, I can predict with some precision, not with, with some precision accuracy, not total accuracy, of course, what would the subjective judgment be? Okay. Here you can't see almost anything, but these are the nine variables in relation. So you have the value of the variable and the value of the final, the subjective judgment. So let's just skip it, doesn't matter. This one, these are the most, again, well, this is just a summary, but this is maybe the most interesting, the two most interesting results. So here we have a map of measured subjective judgment. So this is what actual people said is their subjective evaluation of, on the scale from 1 to 5, okay? And this is what we would be able to predict given the model we have sort of obtained just by knowing the attributes of the street, okay? So if you tell me how this street is done, I can predict how it would be subjectively perceived by. Okay, so think about a series of studies that can be done on these premises. So I have subjective, again, to take example of the data I think I get you have under your hand, is you have a subjective perception, positive, negative, okay? And then you can relate this information on some objective measure characteristics of the environment. And you can see how the two are related, okay? And then model, and then so that you can say, okay, what is the project, which improvements I have to do in my natural park so that the judgment is higher? Let's put it this way, okay? Alors, now, here you can't see almost anything because the contrast is very low, but again, green means class 5, so the highest classified, class 4, it's a lighter green, then yellow is 3, orange is 2, and red is 1, so it's like a traffic light kind of coding. This is what we measured, this is what real values that were given to us, and these are the predictions. So you see the model, I will tell you.
How do you interpret this?
I will, this is one, this is the one, this one tells you which, on which segments you have the biggest error and which were correctly predicted. But maybe some synthetic information is more interesting because it tells you, okay, let's see just the numbers. These are just histograms that show the same data. Okay, so the three models, model A, model B, model C. Remember, the difference between the models is just how many variables I put. The simpler the model, less variables I have. If I don't lose too much of its explanatory power is preferred, of course, because I want to simplify. But of course, if I simplify too much, I lose the complexity. So we take all the three models. So these are the residuals. What does it mean? It means how far a classification has been given with comparison to the true value. The minimum, there is, in the model A, there has been one street that has been classified minus 2.26 less than what the real value of the street was, okay? So these are the residuals. But these are probably the most interesting data, okay? It tells you that with model A and with model B then and with model C, about 55% of all the roads were correctly classified. If it was 5, our model predicts it was 5. 4, 4. It was correct prediction, no matter whether it is 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5. Okay, correctly predicting. One class off, meaning that it was 3 and the model predicted either 2 or 4. One class off the correct prediction. Further, 40%. So you see, the interpretation is that the model in the 95% of the cases is predicting correctly or is just missing by one class. Now, missing by one class on a scale of 5, you know, is it a lot? Is it a little, given the qualitative status nature of this information and all the reserves and caution we have to put into interpreting this information? Is, of course, we can debate about it. But, you know, saying that, tell me for each street 6 or 9 measures like that, and I can tell you how my students from Marghera would subjectively evaluate it, is an interesting result. Nothing counterintuitive has been shown by this study, and many things were, of course, obvious. But you see, if you want to empirically ground your thesis, your model, if you want to calibrate an evaluation model, and either that you need to publish it or you need to use it as a decision support, you have, in a way, to demonstrate that, you know, the parameters are based on something that you have tested, and so they are empirically grounded.
Did you try to map the outlier?
Yeah. These are the outliers. Here, you see, the full gray lines are correctly predicted. Okay? The dashed line, this, you see, dash, are one class off, and the dotted lines are 2 classes off. Okay, just 5% of the, there are no, or almost none, 3 classes off, but of course, 3 classes off means that you have to be 5. It is improbable, even if you were randomly classifying, to have 3 classes off, because, you know, it has to be 5, and we have a little. So again, some interpretational intricacies are there. 95 might not be a high number, considering that, you know, it is in itself, even if you were randomly classifying things, you wouldn't have big, high percentage of 2 classes off or 3 classes off errors. Okay, like randomly take a number 1 to 5, randomly take a number 1 to 5, how many times would you have that the difference between the two is 2 to 3? Okay, so this is the benchmark. This sort of random, completely random, and the accuracy of the, this is the benchmark for the accuracy of the course. But it's an interesting model. Okay. Very briefly, because I want to leave at least 10 minutes for finishing, but we have to do it again, this one, because I had a whole another day to talk to you about a lot of other things. So I think, Antonio, we have to get back to do that, because I had then, and I'm really sorry, because I wanted to show you some other things, not just this, but this is how things went anyway. Anyway, just to briefly mention another empirical study. This one was on crossings. For the walkability, I didn't too much emphasize this issue, but crossings are a different beast. Okay, one thing is that you walk and then you evaluate pedestrian crossings, where you interfere, you conflict with car traffic, are different beasts. Other attributes are relevant, other design solutions are necessary, and so we've done this, again, having a set of physical features, weight of the same, ISLs, facilities for disabled, zebra crossing width, blah, blah, blah. Facilities, traffic lights, and also frequencies of cars, pedestrians, and so on. And we put together in a similar manner, again, getting at the model that would be able to predict us how a pedestrian would evaluate the affordability and the walkability of a crossing. Okay, here again, you don't see it, but these are a set not of all crossings, again, this is a pilot study. Some crossings, the green means that it is measured, it is judged, it is subjectively perceived synthetically as affordable. Okay? And these are those that were predicted through the calibration of multivariate regression model. Okay? And again, 61% precisely measured, 37% one class off, and well, two classes off, just nothing, basically nothing. So, yes, you can measure things and then predict what people would think about it. Not always, but sometimes. And you can then discover patterns. And this is something that you could work with. Okay? Okay, interesting developments, conclusions. Okay, I'm done. I think I can reasonably stop here, although there are many other aspects that, again, we could here draw some conclusions that are related to concepts such as, again, why walking is a fertile capability. I have mentioned it a bit. The fact that all this idea of walkability as improving opportunities and capabilities of people and has to do a lot with the just city, with the right to the city, the two concepts that you might have been are acquainted with, that it allows, again, attention to individual characteristics, specificities. So if you're interested in tourists, again, you can put yourself within the same framework, think about what capabilities tourists value, what optionalities are relevant for them, and then follow the same steps, analytical steps, to come at some policy suggestions. Okay. Streets as public space, and so on and so on. So I will leave just this concept just as a sort of a horizons for further reflection, suggestions, and sort of stimuli for thought. All right. Thank you.